illusionists, the stage illusionists. Their last great golden age came to an end with the last great days of the stage among magicians. There were giants in those days. That was when theater was theater, still beglamored and adazzle with theatricality. By way of homage to those grand old wonder workers, we're going to recreate for you a few moments of illusion in the high old style. Only the tricks will be new.
Orson Welles, author, director, actor, journalist, magician, a star. At 26, he became world famous with his film Citizen Kane. Later masterpieces included The Magnificent Ambersons and Touch of Evil. But the prodigy was hard to handle. Extravagant, rebellious, eccentric. And towards the end of his life, he was branded a burnt-out genius, a spent volcano.
Ladies and gentlemen, I wouldn't fool you for the world.
And here they are, Orson Welles!
1975. 10 years before his death, Welles returned to Hollywood. The AFI honored its prodigal son. He received a Life Achievement Award.
This honor I can only accept in the name of all the Mavericks. A Maverick may go his own way, but he doesn't think that it's the only way or ever claim that it's the best one, except maybe for himself. And don't imagine that this raggle-taggle gypsy-o is claiming to be free. It's just that some of the necessities to which I am a slave are different from yours. As a director, for instance, I pay myself out of my acting jobs. I use my own work to subsidize my work. In other words, I'm crazy. But not crazy enough to pretend to be free. But it's a fact that many of the films you've seen tonight could never have been made otherwise. Or if otherwise, well, they might have been better. But certainly they wouldn't have been mine. The truth is, I don't believe that this great evening would ever have brightened my life if it weren't for this, my own particular contrariety. I leave you now in default of the eloquence this high occasion deserves with another very short scene from the same film, a piece of which you saw earlier with John Huston and Peter Bogdanovich, just by way of saying good night from one who will remember tonight, not as a sort of gala visit, but as a very happy homecoming, and who remains not only your obedient servant, but also in this age of supermarkets, your friendly neighborhood grocery store.
Welles showed excerpts of his latest film, The Other Side of the Wind, his most ambitious project. For him, as important as Citizen Kane.
Mr. Hannaford's night. Let's save the questions for him, huh? You two are very close, aren't you?
Yes, I'd like to ask you about that.
Why?
Come on, Hatterleck. Why do you think you have to be as rude as he is?
As rude as you are, in print anyway.
I liked your last picture. No, I know that it was repetitive, but for what it worked.
Yeah, well, she wasn't that kind to me in her review. Not that you did me too much harm. I mean, how much harm can you do to the third biggest grocer in movie history?
Really make that much? How marvelous.
Yes, did you know that when his own production company goes public, that your friend there stands to walk away with $40 million?
Yeah, and she's going to say that I'm just going to keep on writing that I stole everything from you, Skipper. I'm never going to walk away from that.
Well, it's all right to borrow from each other. What we must never do is borrow from ourselves. Come on.
Of course you're close, you two. You have to be. You have no choice.
Please, dear lady, don't tell us what you mean by that.
Come on.
Wells died in Los Angeles in 1985. The Other Side of the Wind was never released. Though it was almost completed, it remains blocked by legal tangles. Wells never got his new start. His reputation for not being able to complete films was sealed forever. Some have always seen his fame as a great hoax. Others see him as a fallen giant. What did he do in these years? Oja Koda was his muse and collaborator during his last 20 years. He left her a personal archive full of unknown film and fragments. But Oja delayed making it public.
I wasn't really emotionally ready to touch anything of Orson's and our work. People say time cures everything, but for me it took almost 10 years, and still I'm not cured completely. But cured enough to show people that Orson was working last 20 years of his life. Usually they say, so what did he do 20 years? Nothing. He was doing commercials, narrations, but really nothing serious and so on, which is not true.
The aura of the unfinished work has always hovered over Wells. He only completed 12 films, most of them cut, altered, or mutilated by producers. The Magnificent Ambersons, Confidential Report, Touch of Evil. Hardly any film was released the way Wells wanted it. All his countless other projects, only rumors, scraps, assumptions.
Where'd she go?
Ma'am?
Hello? Ma'am? Oh,
oh, okay.
Bulb's burned out. Give me the flashlight, my man. All this for one movie?
No. Have you met since about 10? I'd say 10 movies, at least. It's gonna be a lot of work.
Well, let's get organized. I'm booking the trip tomorrow.
Get the dolly, too.
When you and other people, when they see this material, you will see what a youth he had in him, and what an energy, and what a fun he had. You know, all these things that he was trying to do and couldn't do didn't turn him into a bitter old man. And also he was someone who didn't like to talk about the past and about things that didn't work. He kept saying, sour grapes is not my dish, which, sometimes it's more my dish, but never was his dish. What I want to show is that he was an unbeatable man, that he had an enormous courage, that nothing was going to stop him of making movies. And sometimes in my heart, I hoped that he would stop making movies. because they just to look for money, it takes half of your life. And that's what happened. This is a script of F of Fate. Actually, these are the notes. This is his handwriting.